Hi, everybody, and welcome back to Andréa Mondays on Stars in the House. Oh, it was a beautiful day in New York City today, and I am so glad to finish the day with you all. Thanks for your patience. Went up a little late today because of technical difficulties, but we are good to go and so excited to be here sharing with you. And I'll be here every Monday. It's official. Andréa Mondays are a thing. So thank you so much for all the love you've been showing for Andréa Mondays and the tweets about Peter and I last week were just so much fun. And thank you for that. So if you want to tweet about it, make sure you put the hashtag Andréa Mondays on your little Stars in the House tweet. And thank you so much. Seth and James, who are the best, are actually right now at a Joe Biden fundraiser, organizing that and or working on that. And once again, doing good everywhere. We are now here at Stars in the House, as you know, raising money for the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund. So I want to tell you a little bit about it. It's America's premier every time I read you guys, it just all goes away. The NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund is America's premier legal organization fighting for racial justice. Through litigation, advocacy, and public education, LDF seeks structural changes to expand democracy, eliminate disparities, and achieve racial justice in a society that fulfills the promise of equality for all Americans. So we're very proud to be shifting our giving at Stars in the House for the NAACP. If you would like to donate tonight, please donate to NAACPLDF.org/starsinthehouse. And if you send your donation in, as soon as you get your receipt, please then take it and email it back to starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com for a little shout out. So that's a different one you send it back to, starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com. You'll forward your receipt and that would be wonderful. So thanks for that. You guys, I'm so excited. You know, it is right now, we're all staring at our computers and having Zoom meetings and trying to figure out what the new normal is. But something that's come out of this that's been so great is just reconnecting with friends. I'm sure you guys feel that way too. And I'm so excited to bring my friends out here tonight. Another thing that I love to do on Andréa Mondays is also show you, like, it's also very cool to see how people are connected in, you might know them from doing shows together, but we're all connected in different ways through friendships, through other shows you may not have known about. And I just love tying all of that together. So tonight it's going to be a girls' night in hang with two very dear friends whom I adore, but you might know from a little known TV series called Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. So please welcome the wonderful Gabrielle Ruiz and Donna Lynn Champlin. Hello. Oh, it is girls' night in.
Is it 1 o'clock?
The gems are out.
Yeah, it's 1 o'clock. I mean, it's 1 o'clock somewhere. You know.
Okay, you're in LA. And yeah. Donna Lynn, where are you, my friend?
I'm in New York. I'm in the Hudson Valley right now, just about an hour north of the Cité.
So we're City Mouse, Country Mouse, and LA Mouse.
Yes, we're Hollywood Mouse.
I am pulling out all of the domestic middle-aged mom. I want everyone. It's
and I sparkle. Look at that.
Yes.
And I thank you.
Loves.
Say that again. I'm sorry.
Nothing but the best for you, my loves.
Thank you. I thank you for that deeply. Now, obviously, so many Stars in the House fans know you guys from the incredible show Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, and we'll get to that in a minute, but I wanted to talk a little bit about our history. So I'm going to start with Gabrielle, and people may not know that she made her Broadway debut. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Made her Broadway debut as a replacement in the Heights. So we go back to that. And I want to ask you, first of all, what it was like to come into a show that you'd already, that was already established. And had you seen it before you auditioned for it?
Okay, so my first audition for In the Heights was for the original, like, Broadway launch. The job Krista Rodriguez booked, who
I
a year later, I was green as could be, just graduated from college, was a dance major, and I sang for Telsey, the casting company. She's like, do you dance? And I was like, yeah, I can dance. And so I went to a callback, and I sang I'm Every Woman. had no idea who the team was. Like Lynne, Alex, no clue. Tommy, just whatever. It's a show. I don't know. And I'll never forget after singing I'm Every Woman, Whitney Houston, Lynne at the back of the table, he was like, I love that song. Whoa. And he started singing with me. And I was like, these people are so much fun. I didn't book it. And
Right. Amazing.
And then I went on tour for a year with a chorus line and was in Rhode Island. Lucky enough, could take a train ride to a callback that they brought me in again because Krista was leaving for Adam's Family. So, So I was luckily a little more seasoned, experienced, and I knew what I was doing, maybe, you know, a little bit more. And I saw the show in previews and idolized Priscilla Lopez from the very beginning, the first time I ever saw a chorus line, like one Latina ever in a show. I thought, you know, it was everything, and a dancer. And in previews, I went up to her at the back, at the stage door, and I almost gave her my business card like a freaking nerd. And I was like, Priscilla Lopez, I'm gonna be you. And she was like, okay. And like, I didn't explain anything. That's all I said.
She was like, okay, stalker, very nice. Would you like an autograph? I have a question. You played Morales on that tour, didn't you?
I did play Deanna Wernworth.
So yeah, so that's amazing. So you've been You've been following Priscilla
and
standing in her shoes, literally. That's amazing.
And she signed my sneakers. She signed my sneakers after like a year in the show. I decided not to be a stalker. I decided to be a friend and a colleague and a professional. And then I confessed my story to her. And so she wrote to Deanna from Morales in my sneakers.
Okay.
Guys.
A minute to absorb. Yeah. That is amazing.
What?
Where are those sneakers now?
I think they're in storage, but I will find and take a picture. I definitely made it from New York for sure.
I see closet doors behind you. I'm like, if they're right there, I want you to take them out.
Pull them out.
They're actually probably in that closet in there. I mean, once Donna Lynne starts talking, I might.
Amazing. That is so beautiful. But then you did get the show. And in addition to being kicking in the ensemble, you were Carla understudy. And so that's you in my dressing room. Like we're shared. Danielle and Carla had the same dressing room.
Yeah.
And it was always a joy when you got to go on. And and not only were you a fun person, but also a very, very driven, hyper-focused, type A, get it together. I've got all my stuff together person. So it's been no surprise for me to see like how amazingly your career has taken off, how you've bloomed. And I always say that I'm so proud. I have no right to be, but I am so proud of you.
Oh, thank you. It was so much fun to be in a dressing room with you and like talk, you know. That I guess dressing rooms are just such a special moment in any thespian's life. I think all of you guys can agree with that. You know, you get to really get to know people and getting to know your family and Janet and just like, you know, in and out. Cause I understudied three roles in the show. So I got to get to know everybody from a very personal way. It was so much fun.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
And you know how cute she looked in the costume. Okay. Getting to Donna Lynne. Okay, we have kind of a weird history in a way.
We did. I think we started knowing about each other because we were always up for the same role for like, what was it, like a 5 or 6 year period?
Yes.
And you would get it and then I would get it and you would get it and then I would get it and you would get it. But we would always see each other at auditions and I think we just liked each other.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah. It's like, I like that girl.
Do you want to tell the story or do you want me to tell the story?
I think we both should tell the story, but finally, and you know, it's like you would get it, I would get it. And then sometimes we would replace each other. And
yeah,
like it was always an interchangeable thing. I was like, well, you know, if they're hiring her instead of me, she must be really talented. But I think we would catch each other. We had mutual friends. You went to college with my friend, Katie Finneran. My high school. So, but then we got to work together. I believe it was on a demo recording of Georgia Stitt's musical called Watertown. How about that?
Okay. So this is what happened. I was so excited to like be in a room with you and Georgia. And it was just like a whole bunch of people that I really respected, but I never got a chance to work with. So I was like super psyched about it. And we had to do this really crunchy, tight, was it 6-part harmony?
4 or 5. I don't know, but it was very
intense. And it was tight and it was really crunchy and it was you and me and two dudes.
Yes.
And somebody was off. And
listening to the playback.
And I, of course, you know, because I have a really good ear, I was like, who is it? Who's off? And finally, I don't know how long everybody else knew that it was me, but Andrea comes up to me, just the nicest, sweetest. If you ever want someone to tell you that you're sucking, you want Andrea Burns to do it. Cause she pulled me aside. She was like, listen, I just, I would want to know if it was me. It's you. And I was like, no, I resisted, right? I was like, no, really good pitch. And you were like, okay, cool. And then we did it again.
Okay, no, but wait, that is not the way I remember the story. I do not remember you resisting in any way. I don't remember you resisting. I remember you thinking it. First of all, it was like the ultimate compliment. You are an incredible musician, and we'll get to that, everybody. For those of you who don't know, it's like beyond DLC, beyond. So she's an incredible musician. So I was like, I'm telling somebody who knows. Do you know what I mean? I just was like, girl, it's you. Like, it's cool. It's you. I would want somebody to tell me. But I don't remember. I remember you just thinking it was hilarious that I just like came out said it to you.
The best part was, I'll never forget this. I had gone to the bathroom or something and we were on a break and they had isolated the track in the booth. Just so off. And we were all doubled over. And I asked Georgia, can I please have that? Cause I want that to be my answering machine message. That's how old this is. We still I begged her. I was like, please, for the love of God, let me have that and put it on my answering machine. But it was like, I didn't even commit. Like it was astonishing.
Listen, I've been flat 100,000 times in my life. And I was like, girl, I would want to know. I trust you. You trust me. I'm telling you, girl, it was you. And my memory of it was that after we could not stop laughing.
We laughed. I mean, for at least 5 minutes, it was so funny, but I was so grateful to you. I was so grateful to you because no one else told me. Like we did how many takes where everyone was like, it's somebody.
I just always feel like I would want to know. It's like the spinach in your teeth thing. Like, yes. Just tell me.
You're that friend.
I am that friend. But you are brilliant. And, but I always remember that. I just feel like that was a bond forever. And we just were laughing hysterically and probably laughing hysterically every time we thought of each other for a while after that.
So funny.
Oh my God. But meanwhile, Donna Lynn, I just want to talk about, like, you know, I have great love and respect for you and your talent and have always had that. But don't you feel like at this point in our lives, in our long careers, that isn't it so nice to look at someone you started out with and like go, wow, we're all still standing. And not just standing, you are thriving.
As is Gab. Oh, Gabrielle, you're younger. But just even, you know, it's so funny because when you start out, you know, you're naturally competitive. You naturally think, oh, you know, there's not enough to go around. And then as you stay in it and you get to know your competition and then become friends, it switches. We're like, I mean, Kate Baldwin is our, Kelly O'Hara, Sutton Foster. Like, they're all in our
circle, right? Yes.
Where you look around and you go, oh, yay! Oh, I'm so happy for her. Oh my gosh, she's going to be brilliant. And it, you know, it the wheels turn from looking at somebody as your competition to, if you stay in it as long as we have, so like really, truly being joyously happy.
Yeah.
For each other's successes, you know, you just go, oh my God, yes, she's going to be amazing in that, you know?
I mean, there are those people in the audition rooms for me where we saw each other all the time. And Krista was one of them, like who I keep talking about because, you know, I just feel like I follow her all the time.
Krista who? Sorry, forgive
Rodriguez.
Me. Oh, of course.
Yeah. And so I you know, whenever you see those successes or, you know, like everyone that did On Your Feet, you know, it's just like, I just remember seeing like, oh yeah, they got it. And it was a nice, like, there was always like a group text between some of us, like, who got it? Right. You have one more, you know, let's do them all the sides again, all the songs again. And then we just like, who got the call at 3 p.m.? Because that's who got the call.
But then it's really fun though, because like, you know, if you get older and you work and, you know, you say, okay, I can't do this, but here you call Andrea Burns, you know.
Yeah.
On the list, and you know exactly who to call, who will be amazing. And there's also that too, where you're just like, oh, I'm booked, I can't do it, but you've got to call Andrea Burns. She'd be perfect.
Exactly.
She's available, you know?
Yeah, Jessica and Addie is that for me. We always bounce things back from each other.
Totally. I love that. It's a beautiful thing. And then you get to like, you know, where Donnellan and I have been so strung out on motherhood that you're like at an audition and you're totally sleep deprived and you're looking at each other, you're like, I hope you get it. No, you get it, girl. I can't handle this right now. I hope you get it.
Oh my God. Should I tell the Lorca story?
Yeah. Yeah, okay. You can tell that story.
So Andrea's son was, I mean, really, really young, like I think under a year. And I didn't have kids yet. And I had no concept. And so I saw her at this Lincoln Center sort of dance call for a Lorca musical, something or other. I think it was Graziella Danielle.
Yeah. My hero, one of my heroes.
I was so excited to see you because I knew you just had the baby, you know? So of course I'm imagining like this Disney sort of 1950s June Cleaver, like, and she, Gabrielle, she came up so close to my face, and she was just, I was like, hey, mama, how's it going? How's the baby? I gave you a big hug. And then you were like, they don't tell you. They don't tell you. And I was like, they don't.
Like I've been abducted.
Like they don't tell you how exhausted, like I'm so exhausted. And it was like, okay, everybody. my friend.
It's such a testament to you though, because you and I don't see each other that often, but you were like a beacon. You're like a safe spot in the room that I could just be like, oh my God, I'm having the hardest time. I'm so sleep deprived. This is so hard.
And then 5, 6, 7, 8.
And then 5, 6, 7, 8, honey. That's how it is.
I had my son though, I'm telling you, that was one of the very first things that came back to my mind, because I literally was like,
they don't tell you.
I get it. They don't tell you.
No.
They don't tell you.
No, we're trying to have kids and nobody tells you how to have kids. Everyone tells you how to not have kids since high school.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
True.
I'll call on you soon, hopefully.
Yes.
Welcome aboard, mama.
Yes, but there are roads. There are roads we must walk ourselves to understand.
Yes.
You know, you got to swim across the channel yourself to really know what it feels like to be on the other side.
Yeah. So,
but that is hilarious. I want to throw back real quick because I have a fun clip and I just want to, speaking of Donna Lynn's flatness, let's go to like her incredible musicianship. I'm saying that because honestly, I don't think you guys know.
What are you going to show?
I just feel like you're such an accomplished musician. And of course you got to show off so many incredible facets of that on Crazy X. And that's why I'll also like you're mine. I'll also love Rachel forever for just knowing what to showcase about you. Like every time another number, I'd be like, yes, yes. They get her. They see her. They're letting her do all her magic. Yes, yes, yes. But you were in that 2006 production of Sweeney Todd.
Yes, I was. Yeah.
Where everybody played instruments.
Mm-hmm.
And I have just a little clip of that on the Tonys with Patti LuPone and Michael Cerveris.
Yay.
I want you to see real quick just what she's up to, just a little bit in the background, like behind the scenes. Can we roll that?
A Sweeney Todd.
Wait, that was so fast, but that was her on the accordion.
Can I tell you a secret about
that? Yeah, please.
Okay, so when you're doing a musical and then the musical's nominated for a Tony, you have, what is it, 2.5 minutes, 3 minutes? What is it? I can't remember. I don't know. It's a limited amount. And sometimes what either you take an existing number in your show and you cut it down, or you do like a montage and sort of snip and tuck that.
You're talking about performing on the Tonys, right?
Right. And so the problem is, though, is that you are doing your show 8 times a week, which is the complete thing. And then you're also rehearsing and teching for the Tonys, which is a part of your show that's not what you do 8 times a week.
Right.
Right? So normally that's, you know, really, really, really tough on your brain. But then you add that we are all playing all of the instruments. So when we think of a cut, we have to not only do the vocal cut, but then the instrumental cut underneath.
Yeah.
It was just a little too hard. And I think I'm pretty sure on that, on the Tonys, somebody jumped. I don't know who it was. It had to have been either Patty, Michael, or Mono, because they were the only ones who I think actually sang. But somebody jumped a cue.
Uh-oh.
And all of us, you can see on my face. If you watch that whole cue, you can see on my face, because I was also the onstage conductor. And you can see my face where somebody jumped and went to the 8 shows a week cut as opposed to the Tony cut. Mm-hmm. And then I'm standing there thinking, oh my God, okay, wait. So if we went there, then we got to go back here and we got to go do this. We got to zigzag so that we make our time. And but what's.
And how did you, and did you guys manage to do it? Well,
somehow we all symbiotically, because we had been playing together for like, I think 9 months at that point. We all kind of like all had the mind meld of whoops, okay, yeah. That's eight measures back. And now we have to fast forward 12 measures. We have to double back 4.
Oh,
and somehow, but you can see it on my face.
Oh my gosh. I wish I knew that story. So I would have that exact clip. Can we, what do we have a little longer and a little more of what I wanted to show?
I was standing behind Patty. And I felt bad because I watched it, you know, after we had done it. And I was like, please don't read it on your face. Please don't show it. Go, oh, there it is.
Oh, there it is.
There's the panic. There it is.
Can we show the other clip of Donna Lynn?
Yeah, that was the cool part. I think it was, yeah, I was still on the accordion because I think I had to stomp. And get everybody back.
Okay, so what we're saying basically is on the Tonys, you were playing the accordion, playing the flute, and conducting, while
and
also appearing
as Corelli.
Well, and also Alex Germignani too. Alex Germignani was mostly on all of our keyboards, and he's just like a phenomenal genius. And I'm sure 80% of getting us on track was he playing the right thing on the piano, and we all just went, oh, right. You know, I can't take credit for that. I'm sure it was 90% Germignani.
Oh my
but
God.
It's just fascinating that if you look at my face, you can see the moment where I go, oh, shit.
Oh my God. Well, now I'm going to be obsessed with that, and now I'm going to look that up. So thank you. Or you all can. It's on YouTube. Sweetie Todd Tony. Look for the crazy look in her eye. That's amazing. But honestly, you were so incredible in that production. And it was just every time because you're just such an excellent actor, and you're such a funny and excellent comedian that people put you out there. Yeah. And you just go, oh, she's just really good at that. It's like, no, she's actually good. She's actually amazing at like 100 more things.
Yeah.
And that's what I've always been obsessed about with you. So, speaking of being amazing at a lot of things, I want to bring this back to Gabrielle. Gabrielle and I had the opportunity last summer. We were at Vassar at New York Stage and Film working on an adaptation, I guess I can say, right? of like Water for Chocolate, the amazing movie, and which I was obsessed with in the 90s. And it's really a really beautiful adaptation. And I hope it does come to Broadway because we had a great time working on it. And Gabrielle had a special, so we're just doing like our summer gig, but like auditions are still coming in. People are asking for tapes and self tapes. And so Gabrielle said to me, listen, will you listen to something? I had this weird request yesterday. It's for an animated thing. I don't know. They wanted me to be a raccoon on this. animation thing. And I was like, oh, okay, cute. Like a little animated raccoon. Like, what's your raccoon voice going to be? She was like, no, they wanted me to actually
natural,
authentic, natural raccoon sounds, right?
Yes, that's exactly what happened. Natural raccoon sounds, no animation, no like cartoon raccoons.
No.
Natural, please. So I literally got on YouTube and I was like watching videos of very upset raccoon videos, like being stuck in trash cans and like they got caught in traps and stuff. And you're just like, okay, then, is this it?
So I tell you how Gabrielle is so, she's so focused. She's so type A. She puts everything. She's 150% and such precision. I was like, sure, I'll listen to your raccoon. First of all, I was like, this is not human sound. This is clearly an animal in the wild.
It's amazing.
Okay. Not only was it an amazing replica of a raccoon, but like the 20-second tape had an arc.
It went through all of the, it started
all of the emotions. It was like, oh, I'm a cute raccoon. Wait, someone's coming. Uh-oh, I'm hurt. I'm trapped.
I kill you, raccoon.
There's a whole story.
I was so blown away. She was right. I just was like, you are so talented.
Oh my God, thanks.
You turn this thing that is like, why would I do a raccoon tape? What is this? Do you know what I do? Who I am? I'm amazing. It's such a testament to who you are as an artist. I'm obsessed with that. I use the raccoon emoji whenever I text Gabrielle because I'm like, I know I can trust you to do anything. You're amazing.
You said your favorite moment though of that voiceover clip was my introduction. Because it's like, Gabrielle Ruiz, raccoon.
Yes. I spent a lot of time, you guys, I spent a lot of time dissecting this. This is why Seth Rudetsky and I are friends. Because I had to like deconstruct the whole thing. And I was like, first of all, the introduction, totally confident name. And then I'm so game.
Let's like, do it, man.
Gabrielle Ruiz, raccoon. Just like you always knew you wanted it. I was obsessed with the slate. It had so much.
Oh, well, you know, I haven't booked it. It's been a year. And I am still waiting for that phone call because I'm still rather confident that it's my best audition yet.
Listen, guys. Yeah,
they're going to call.
You booked a gig. Tell the people the gig. Are you allowed to tell?
I can't. No. I can't. But there's other voiceover gigs that are really, really great. I'll just say that they're super. So that's my hint. And it's been really super fun, like, to do that during quarantine. Thank God there's been some work in, like, my closet, you know?
That's amazing. Congratulations.
Oh, my God. Thank you. I can't wait to reveal it for real.
That's super, super news. And by the way, Disney, I hope you're listening. The best raccoon you could ever find. Gabrielle Ruiz.
Yeah.
And I know you want a Latina raccoon because you need one.
You can hear it. You can hear the Latina in the raccoon.
It's just, you guys, it's art. That's all I have to say about that. Yeah. Okay. So you guys, let's cut to Crazy X.
Let's do it. Let's dive in.
I'm dying to know, as your pal, as a Broadway person, like what it was like to go into a TV reading, like the first time you were on the table and go like, wait, seriously? They want to do this? I don't know. What was that? Was that surprising?
Oh, Donna Lynn and I have had many, many conversations about this. Where do we begin? It's not that bad. No. I mean, Donna Lynn, you did the pilot, so your story is a little different from mine.
Well, it's funny because just brass tacks without the musical elements in it. it was, as a theater person, you know, I had no concept of what it was like to do on camera work, really. I had done like, you know, a day on Law and Order where I had to like be like, the body's over there. Like, I didn't really need to like, do you know what I mean? I didn't really need to know anything. And I remember I was so grateful because the crew for the pilot was so generous with me. You know, and like everything, time is money. It moves so fast. And I remember I had done a scene and I was just trying not to, you know, crap myself because I was so nervous because I knew I didn't know what I was doing. And so we did a scene and then we did a different perspective or from somebody's point of view. And then all of a sudden, it was all different. Cause you know, for a perspective, they move stuff around so that it matches the wide and the two shot and all that stuff. And they were like, okay, rolling. And I saw like an X, like sort of 6 feet away from where the guy had been before, but I couldn't put it together that the X was the guy because the guy was there. That's where the X is. And I went, oh my God, I'm so sorry, stop. I'm so sorry, before I waste a lot of money and time. Is that X for me? What is that? If that X is for me, what does it mean? What's happening?
Right.
And the guy, the camera A op was so great. He literally, he came over and he went, are you from the theater?
Yeah. Thank you.
I was like, please just explain to me really quick. I know we're like rushing. And he was like, no. He said, let's take a minute. He took the lens off the camera, brought me behind the camera, showed me the lens and said, listen, here's the perspective. Here's that. This is why the X is there, because we're on the other side of the camera. And like this whole technical aspect, you know, so I was very lucky. And I think even just the regular Crazy X crew was incredibly generous, because more than half of us were theater people.
And also Rachel Bloom is a huge theater like fan. I mean, she went to school at NYU for theater and, you know, so she was just so excited to do musical.
And so supportive and so, you know, and I mean, but like the whole season one, my nickname on set, deservedly so, and with lots of love, was Sketch.
Wait, say that again, because Gabrielle was laughing. Hold on.
My name on set for season one was Sabotage. With love, and I deserved it.
Why?
I didn't really like understand, because you know, in the theater, it's like, okay, be at number one. But within number one, you've got a good 2 feet give, I mean, or a foot give. You know what I mean? Like,
come
on. You're in a pool of light. It's not like that, right?
Right.
You have to hit your mark on your tape on the floor.
That little X is like this big.
Within an inch, if you're not, you're either blocking somebody's light or you're blocking somebody's shot or you're sabotaging somebody somewhere. And I just could not, like the minutiae of the technical aspect was so hard. And in the theater, people will just tell you, people will be like, move over.
Right. Or shove with love. You know, people just shove.
There's like a protocol where like they're not allowed to talk to the actors and tell the actors what to do, and it takes time and it goes through this and the AD and then the director and I finally just at one point literally made an announcement. I think it was episode 4 where I was like, listen, everybody, I am learning. I feel like I'm an immersive, like foreign language camp. I don't know what a banana is. I don't know what a rat is. I don't know. And I am inviting all of you. I don't care who it is. Hair, makeup, camera A, camera B. I don't care. If I am screwing something up, tell me. Tell me, I'm not going to be upset. I want to know so I don't waste everybody's time and everybody's money.
If I'd been upset, I would have told you.
I know. We should have been there on set to tell Donna Lynne how to make this happen. She'd be like,
no. I wouldn't have known. I would feel the same way. I find it, you know, I find it so daunting every time I'm on a film or television set, because it's just not our world. It's not what we were trained to do.
The thing is, I was like, if you taught a class, like Gabrielle, you'd be brilliant at this if you this, but the problem is
a raccoon. Right.
Yes, how to be a raccoon. No, like what we need out there is like a on-camera class that actually uses cameras and, you know what I mean? Because, and lights and tape, and because it's so hard to teach an on-camera class. You can learn how to act on camera.
Right. Sure. But the whole process of a set
is impossible to teach without being on a set, I think.
Right.
Correct. Yeah. And that's the most intimidating. You're like, forget the actual acting. It's just about, oh my God, where am I going to stand? Am I going to sabotage this? Am I going to ruin it for everyone? Look at you. I feel you.
Too, like continuity. Like before we would shoot, they literally would hand me like keys, a purse, pencils, a bag of decorations, a blah, blah, blah. And then on the first wide shot, you have to make the decision that I'm going to say and put it down and always have it in the right hand. And this will be in the left hand. And then that's it. Like,
that's it.
theater, we have the luxury of 2 weeks of rehearsal to decide, you know what? I think.
If you watch,
it's Friday night. I think I'm going to do it on this side, right?
If you watch I'm So Good at Yoga, the actual music video, you'll see me do like this flip on a guy. Like I put my legs like get on the shoulders of a guy from like a handstand and I fix my costume. And that's a very theater thing, is you fix it while you do it.
What's the choreography?
You don't do that on television because they'll use that take. They'll use the fixed take.
Yep.
And me and Donna Lynn would just like, we never learned our lesson. Like there was a moment where like I was doing like a sliding split in a number in the Triceratops ballet or something. And I kind of stumble and then fix it. And Donna Lynn finally, like her and I, like at season 3 or 4, we were like, you've got to ruin the take. Like fall, flash, whatever you got to do, because they're going to use it.
And they'll use it. Yeah.
Wow.
But also, we are looking at, like, we as actors, we are dancers. We are only, of course, looking at our line, our this, our that. Whereas the producers, you know, they're looking, that's one of 100 things you're looking at. And if they've got a shot where, you know, maybe your thing is not the best, but everything else lines up,
right?
All 99 other things line up, they're gonna take. And you know,
the crazy thing for me that I learned was for the whole cast, by the time we did from like season 1 to 4, it evolved where there were just all a lot of solo numbers in season 1. And then season 2, we started backing each other up a little bit. And then season 3, there were a lot of like quadruple it numbers, like let's generalize about men. And then the final season was huge ensemble numbers, I would say.
I love that. That made me so happy.
Getting in a dance room with not only theater people, but with comedians and improvisers, because a third of the cast was like UCB improvisers. The other third were stand-up comedians. And the other third were theater kids. And you knew exactly who everyone was in that rehearsal room.
It's true.
It was like a little, like, it's like whatever those, like, you can only see the window, like, you can only see through the room through that window one side, like, with the cops use or whatever, you know, like, it's like this study, you know, and,
so
and
what were the salient, the standout features about each group?
Well, like, Dave Hall and me, for instance, or in Donna Lynn, they were like, okay, so Dave, will you just lift Gabrielle? And we're like, great. Okay, what's next? And then they were like, and all the stand-up comedians were like, whoa, making a bit out of it.
You want me to do that? I can do that. Skip aside, baby, don't do it.
My dancers don't talk in a dance studio.
You just get it done.
You listen, you get it done. And the comedian and the improvisers fill in the space of the silence. That's what you do in improv. Right? Like you fill in silence with.
Okay, so hold on. I have a clip, an amazing clip of you guys in one of the final big ensemble numbers, season 4. And also, P.S., it starts out with Donna Lynn also doing something else you didn't know she could do. So and then I want to talk about it. I want to analyze after. Can we roll that clip?
I can't wait.
No, this is Donna Lynn.
Odds, sixes, dice, monogamy.
Love's not a game. Love's not a game. That being said, let's make it rain. While Cupid flies in from above,
the group mind has decided to bet on love.
Love's not a game, love's not a game, love's not a game. Josh should be wary of parasail.
Okay, first of all, in case you didn't recognize the little gangster in the hat doing those crazy turns, tap dancing like a maniac, that's my girl. That's my girl right there. That's my girl right there.
Where did Gabrielle go?
I think she was just handling a little tech thing. She'll be right back.
Well, okay. Yes. And the thing is, again, like as a dancer, I look at that and I go, oh, I had so many better takes. Like by the time that take, I remember that take. I remember that take because I was upset at myself because I fell out of something. But when you do these, you do them over and over. Like, again, in the theater, you have weeks and weeks to build up your muscles, get your endurance, be able to do the shows 8 times a week. We would rehearse the number once, in a massive rehearsal, like on a Sunday. And then we would shoot it for like 10 or 12 hours. And so my muscles, Gabrielle, you remember this?
I remember.
Gabrielle gave me.
Well, I mean, it's also like, it's like that tech week, you know, you just got to really just like save it, preserve, execute, and wait, you know, and again, like stand-up comedians didn't know how to survive a dance day. And I was like, we need to have a warm-up. Like can I please warm up Pete Gardner? Cause he can't be out. He doesn't understand. God bless him. Like, he was just like, it's so much fun, but after a while, like, it hurts, you know? And we're dancing on cement. Like, there's no actor's equity cushion floor.
No, okay. My thighs, by the time that take happened, my thighs were on fire. Like, my thigh muscles weren't really working anymore. And I remember I turned to Gabrielle, because Gabrielle is right next to me before I go down that line. And I looked at her, and I was like, I literally said, I'm almost 50. What? I'm almost 50. And
I turned to her and I said, for four seasons, Donna Lynn, you've been trying to get them to make you do a freaking tap dance number. And this
I is was it. Waiting. I was waiting I was for like, four seasons.
I was like, you better. And they're going to use that shitty take. And you better do this right every single freaking time. Get it together, Broadway. Get it together, Chaplin. And she was like, you're right.
Copy that. Thank you. Thank
Sometimes
you.
The kids have to tell us to pull up. Sometimes we count on those kids to get us to pull up.
She was like, you asked for this. Girl. You got to show the kids forever. I said, it's forever on Netflix, girl. Do it right.
I know.
Well, it's spectacular. It's spectacular. You nailed it.
It was so much fun. I absolutely loved it. I love that number too. And David Hall. Can we talk about David Hall?
David Hall leading it.
Four seasons, sleeper performer of the show. Slaying it.
And they totally they broke down that bar. That's the actual bar's set. And they broke that wall. And it was a very permanent breakdown of, you know, that was never going to be used again. It was a really special day. It was a really special day.
So let me just be clear. I want to get clear on something. So were you in rehearsal? Like, when you learned the steps, was that like a separate, you were in a rehearsal room, or did you just learn everything and shoot it all the same day?
I mean, it was all from season one to four of how to do rehearsal. Cause Donna Lynn and I were like helping Catherine Burns, our amazing dance choreographer, for the entire four seasons. She did all styles, all comedy. Like, and she, I mean, was astounding. Totally Emmy Award worthy, like she did win. And Donna Lynn and I were like, we need to communicate with them on, like, explain that rehearsal's really great and we just need a little bit of time. And poor Rachel's like being pulled with editing, post, makeup, blah, blah. And so we were like, we need to like protect, we just need to like help everyone realize, like, let's have like an hour. And then let's take a break in 20 minutes, like after 30 minutes or after 90 minutes. And it was very helpful that they listened. They were like, got it.
Well, on television, it's, of course, a totally different set of issues and problems, especially if you're up and running, right? So you've got people shooting, so they're not available. To find a time, especially for a group member, where everyone's available is impossible, so it doesn't happen. But also because there's so many cogs in the wheel of people who have to sign off on what you're doing. It's astonishing.
It's
so we would do a version of, say, generalized, right? Kat would choreograph something. We would, four of us or the three of us, and a body double for Rachel, or Kat would be Rachel, because Rachel was always, of course, obviously busy. Wow. And we would do the choreography. They would tape it. But then that tape would go around to the producers and then the brass and then, you know, all of the people, and then the notes would come back. But unfortunately, with changes, but unfortunately, because we were in the machine, there was not enough time to go back into rehearsal.
Yeah.
To learn the change. And so, you know, it's really sort of renegade rehearsing on 10 minute breaks or turnarounds or whatever. And then, you know, it's just a tricky business to sort of, by the time you get to shooting, to remember accurately what version was decided on. And sometimes we would do like two different versions of something if maybe they liked both and wanted to have both in the can. And so it was, it was just very, because of the setup of being on a set and in the process and Rachel shooting and rehearsing is, you know, very, very different.
Rehearsal as we know it, clearly.
And then teaching, you know, Donna Lynn, like about the lens and pulling them aside, we got to do that with the dancing, the rehearsing, the, you know, theater, theatrical feeling of that. And then there were moments with Pete Gardner, who was an improviser. He was like, do you want to improv with me? Like on this next scene? I was like, no, I'm not
gonna do it. Pete is such an expert. I mean, he's literally one of the best, I think, in the country, in the world, hands down. And so I would always be like, I'll be your straight man.
Yep.
I'll set you up.
And I'm going to think about what I'm going to say before I say it, because I'm going to do it.
I'm going to do this. And you just hit it. No, I don't think there's any rising to the level of Pete Gardner. I don't think it's possible. So I would always be like, I'm a straight man, you. I'm just lob you stuff and you just go.
It was really cool to have all three worlds collide and learn from each other on Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. That was the coolest thing I took away from the show, for sure.
That was unbelievable.
In this other project that I did, I actually did a lot of improv and I actually kept texting Pete going, you are so proud of me. Pete,
Now let's talk, as a matter of fact, so there's a couple things moving on. I asked Gabrielle if she would share a little musical moment with us.
Yes.
But while she's setting up, Donna Lynn, you have a movie out. Will you talk to us about that?
Yes, it's called Feel the Beat. It's on Netflix. There it is. There's Miss Sophia Carson on the left, and then the wonderful Kaizen on my right. It's basically a Bad News Bears for dancers. It's a great family film. And it's, you know, it's not so saccharine-y sweet. Like, it's got a little funny bite to it. It's a really good, it's a really great movie, and it's, you know, very firmly in the genre that it is. But we've been on the top 10 of Netflix downloads in the world.
Wow.
Since we came out on the 19th. And I think one, it's a really good movie. Sophia Carson is exceptional. Alyssa Down directed it.
It sounds just what we need right now. It's just like upbeat, happy.
Good people trying to do good people in absurd situations, you know. And I think people are just sort of really sort of enjoying it. Like a nice bath. It's like a nice. The world is a dumpster fire, and then you watch it for like an hour and a half, and you just sort of, you know, escape into this, you know, small town world where people are nice to each other and they try to do the best that they can, you know. But it's actually a really great film. It's a really great family film if you have kids, especially. My boy is 8, and he's seen it 3 times. I come down in the morning, and he's got it on. So, you know, it's not like,
what is it like for an 8-year-old to see his mom on TV and in movies? It just must be such a funny thing.
Weird, because he was 4 when we started Crazy Ex, when we went out to LA. And so he's always been on the set and always, you know, so I think it's kind of just part of his, I don't think he thinks it's like all that cool.
Right. Well, because he's been on the set. Like, I'm wondering, like, maybe was he around the set on Feel the Beat? Like, I imagine Crazy Ex just feels like, you know, my son Hudson grew up at In the Heights backstage. Like, that's just par for the course. But something, maybe a movie that you weren't in and ta-da, now it's on Netflix that he
We shot in Toronto. So he only came up a couple of times. His biggest thing was he wanted to meet Sophia. He was at a new school in New York, because we moved back to New York. And he, of course, very casually, they were talking about The Descendants, which that's Sophia's big 3 movies, is The Descendants. Right. And he was like, oh, my mom knows Miss Sophia. And he's the new kid, right? And they were like, oh, really? And he was like, yeah, I met her. I went to Toronto. I took a picture with her. She's really nice. And they were like, And then I was still in Toronto and he told me the story and he was like, Mommy, I don't understand. They didn't believe me. Like, to him, it was like, why wouldn't you believe me? And I said to my husband, I was like, you print out that picture and you put it in the box so you can take that and show those kids that he's not lying. And he went from the new weird kid who was possibly a big liar to like the coolest kid.
Mr. Legit cool.
I will forever be grateful to Sophia Carson for that.
Amazing. I love that. I love that so much. All right, Gabrielle, are you ready?
I'm ready, Mommy.
Okay, tell us about what you're going to do. This feels like very special because we've all seen it on the show, but this is a live at-home performance. So set this up for us.
Hold on. Raccoon. Is that it? Oh, that's not it. That's not it. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. That's my raccoon.
Okay, wait, just for those of you, this is Gabrielle Ruiz doing the raccoon recording I told you about. I love that she pulled it up. You guys, just listen. Okay, can we hear this?
Okay. It keeps going, you know, it's 2 more minutes.
I the length, it was like 45 full seconds of raccoon.
I'm ready to sing my song.
It's just full on. I just like, I wish this was like a raccooning award that I could just give to you.
I'll take it.
Can you believe that, Donna? Because I mean, just listening to it, you're just like, oh, that's my God.
And my response was, A, you booked it, and B, now I know why I don't book voiceovers, because
the bar is that high.
It all makes sense now.
Right?
So, I know.
That was amazing. Thank you.
So thank you. So Valencia was in her before life a raccoon, and so we transitioned to this opening moment, which is episode like 102, season one, episode two. And what's so special about this song, I'm So Good at Yoga, is they didn't know what to do during the table read when the song happened. And like, you know, the Broadway performers that we are, I was like, I can sing it for you. And all of CBS, CW, you know, Aline and Rachel were like, you can. And so it was just so much fun to like represent Broadway, represent theater, represent New York City.
Yes, and just to be clear on that, right, because most television actors would be like, no way, not till I'm rehearsed, not till I've done like a million, you know, and you were right at the read. You're like, oh, would you like me to just do it for you right now?
And she killed it. She killed it.
It was just nice to like be really proud to be like a Broadway thespian, you know, and especially today with the news of 2021, like things, you know, not being able to open and stuff. It's just like, that's really what this song does for me, is like remind me that I am one of the Broadway vets that can represent it on television. It's really special that they brought a lot of New York kids over, you know?
This
is I'm So Good at Yoga. You ready?
Yes, so excited. Thank you.
We're in a yoga class. Now is the time to let your mind go blank and focus instead on how awesome the yoga teacher is. Look at me, I'm so good at yoga. Look at me, I'm so good at yoga. Exhale another sigh, Rebecca Bunch sucks. I do stuff with my body that no human should be able to do, like putting my hands behind my knees, turning my hands into a shoe as the morning sun kisses the lotus. I kiss my own hoo-ha. Can you do that? Greet each day. Namaste. Screw your fat. Look at me. I'm so good at yoga. Look at me. I'm so good at yoga. Look at me! I'm so much better than you. You can take child's pose if you want. Then she goes, I'm an adult. I'm not afraid to get tattoos, and they are all in Sanskrit. But stuff doesn't hurt at all. Most times I prefer it. That's what this tattoo says. I'm so good at yoga. I'm so good at yoga.
I'm not afraid of clowns and trains. My father didn't leave me. I'm so good at yoga.
Yay! Brava! Brava! That was so amazing. So funny.
Oh, man. What a time. What a time.
What a time. But I just remember being, I was watching that like with my mouth, with my jaw on the floor. Because it was just so, I was so proud of you, slash, it was so impressive, slash, she was doing, like she was saying, she was flipping over her head. I think actually Hudson was able to find the clip of you in that you spoke about and I'm so good at yoga. So can we run it?
I'm so good at yoga.
Yeah, I fixed it. I fixed it. Just throw it down. Just throw the costume down.
Can we roll it one more time? Wait, tell me what I'm looking for in the fix. I missed it.
So I do a flip on, like you see my legs hang on the shoulders and then my body comes up above his head. And there's like the banner of my outfit is on my face like this. And I get my hand, I push it down. Play it again.
One more time.
I'm so good at yoga. I come.
Getting things done. Fixing it.
Get it done, you know.
Get it done. Get it done. That was amazing. And I'm sure most of you have seen this incredible series, but if not, get B2 Netflix now and see this. This is incredible. I think I have to check in. Hold on. I think it's donations time. I'm running a little over.
Donnellan, I'm so glad I was able to like work with you because I just always admired you and we had never worked together until Crazy Ex-Girlfriend.
Our paths never crossed. And I don't know if people know this, but Valencia was only supposed to be 2 or 3 episodes.
She was supposed to be on the island.
Gabrielle was so amazing and awesome to work with and everyone loved her so much that it literally the part of Valencia became was through all the seasons. So
my favorite was Rachel would always be like, God, you're just so nice.
Don't you love stories like that? I actually love to hear that. Like somebody came in for one episode or something and they just fell in love with it. They're like, let's build it all around you. And it is really cool to think, Gabrielle, that if it wasn't you in the part, Valencia may not
have been. Would have been different.
Which is it's so amazing. I'd like to shout out Carly for donating $50 during this episode. Thank you, Carly. Thank you for the love. And lastly, I just want to say thank you to you ladies. I am so grateful for your friendship, for your talent, for your inspiring work in the world. And again, I'm just like grateful to call you friends. So thank you so much for joining me tonight. And you know, it's so amazing to be able to be able to call people on the phone and be like, want to be my guests on the show? And they're like, oh my God, yes.
You know what's weird though is because you're the host, but I feel like it's been so lopsided. Like I kind of feel like I want to be like, but what about you? You didn't talk nearly enough, Andrea. Like it's this weird, like you're my buddy, but it's like you're the host. But I'm just like, talk more, Andrea. I want to know like what's happening.
Call me.
We chatted yesterday. That was good.
We'll do another FaceTime.
We'll have to just watch Donna Lynn's raccoon animated little tidbit from Crazy Ex-Girlfriend.
You know? Yeah, YouTube, the raccoon. It's very special.
I'm feeling a little peer pressure that I might need to be doing a raccoon thing soon. So I'm just saying, anybody out there, whatever, I'm open.
I'm a fails.
Raccoon really incredible raccoon mentors is all I'm saying. Thank you. But ladies, thank you so much. You know, I love and adore you both. Thank you for making this such a fun girls' night in hang. And I adore you. So,
thanks for donating.
Yes. And thanks to Carly again. Weren't they amazing? I mean, I always end these episodes thinking, I'm so lucky to be able to talk to such great, interesting, fun, collaborative artists, but also so thrilled to be able to call them my friends. And I'm so lucky to be able to call you my friends. I just want to thank you so much for hanging with me every Monday. It makes such a difference in these times, which are so unpredictable every day, to know that I can just hang out on a Monday with like-minded folks who geek out over the same things I do. And I never thought I'd feel this way. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm glad I got the chance to say that I do believe I love you. And if I should ever go away, well, then close your eyes and try to feel the way you do today. And then if you can remember, keep smiling, keep shining, knowing you can always count on me for sure. That's what friends are for. In good times, in bad times, I'll be on your side forevermore. That's what friends are for. Thank you for joining me, friends. Thanks for coming to Andréa Mondays, and we'll see you next week. Take care of yourselves. Bye.
Women gotta stick together each and every day. Women gotta stick together in each and every way. Females helping females for the greater good. Sisters helping sisters. That's called sisterhood. Women have the power, the power to make a change. Like this girl should pluck her eyebrows, and those jeans should be exchanged.